So I'm back with a quick look at some new features in Darktable 4.8. Darktable 4.8 was released a few weeks ago. They kind of slipped it out on us. Well, I say that, but this is their normal summer release. There are two releases a year, one around Christmas time and one in June, July kind of time frame. This one doesn't have a whole ton of new features like recent previous releases, but it does have a few new things that I think merit going over and looking at. And I'm going to start with this image, and I picked this image not because it's the greatest photograph in the world, but because it has a strong red background that's going to illustrate some of the ways we can use and abuse these new tools. First things first, I've already come in and done a lens correction, a diffusion sharpen for no AA filter, and I've cut on sigmoid. And sigmoid is where I wanted to go first to show some of the new features in that module. But actually first, I'm going to go ahead and adjust the exposure up here a little bit. Make sure we aren't really blowing anything out. Not too bad. All right. Yeah, we'll kind of tweak that down a little bit later. Actually, it might be a little bit hot. We'll kind of bring that down a little bit. All right. You'll also notice that I have replaced the histogram with a vectorscope here, which is a way to show color information on a color circle. So, you know, red, yellow, green, cyan, magenta, or cyan, blue, magenta, excuse me. And the way this works is that this is like a neutral gray. And this is a vector, hence the term vectorscope, so it's a direction and an intensity of the data in the image. So you can see there's not a lot of blue, there is some red and some orange. We can kind of tell that by looking, but this gives us a quantifiable way of judging that. It'll be important when we start working with these tools. So back into the sigmoid module. This looks kind of the same, fairly the same. You know, you've got your contrast and your skew up here, and you've got the attenuation settings down here still. So, you know, you can come in and inset what's called inset, and this vector scope shows why it's called an inset, because you're insetting the color or the hue, the chroma. That's the hue is this layer. Chroma is the distance from center. And so you're insetting that towards the center, right? Sorry guys, I'm gonna stumble a little bit for words sometimes when you get on camera and start talking about these things. I'm not even on camera, I'm just on mic. You lose 20 IQ points. And when you only got 6 or 7 to deal with, well, whoops, things are gonna get a little hairy. So you can use these sliders to inset or attenuate the chromacity of your red here, and you can see it's getting less red the more you ramp that up. Same with the green and the blue. Those are just going to be probably less obvious, especially by the time I run this through compression and YouTube completely does whatever it's going to do to it. That may not come through as well as the red. That's why I picked this image again, because it's very strong color, very strong example. If you overdo it a little bit and you say you attenuate the red but it takes it out a little too much, you can use the recover purity slider to bring a little bit of it back. And you can see, looking at the vector scope up here again, that vector is getting stronger, so we are recovering some of it. So you've got kind of a push-pull thing you can do. The new sliders are these rotation sliders. They're all set at 0 by default. And you might be thinking, rotate, how do we rotate a color? Well, there's this thing called the color wheel. If you've not seen this before, you're not terribly familiar with it, it's okay. I didn't come out knowing everything myself either. I wasn't born knowing everything. But this is a thing that artists and photographers and video people, all kinds of people to work with color, kind of use this as a way to define what color they're talking about in degrees. So, you know, each hue gets its own degree, basically. So just like here on the vector scope, you've got reds at 0, 180, we've got a cyan, 300 is a magenta, 240 is a blue, 120 is a green, and 60 is kind of yellow. This one's just kind of kicked over to where the 0 degree red is at about 3 o'clock instead of on the vector scope where the 0 degree red is at 12 noon. But other than that, it is the same thing. So when they're talking about rotating it, they're talking about rotating it on this wheel. Now if we go back to here, we'll notice that you can only rotate it 22.9 degrees positive and 22.9 degrees negative. This is meant to be a minor tweak kind of a tool. So if we go back to our color wheel, we can see 60 degrees is yellow, about half of that would be about 30 degrees is there. So 20 is probably a little something in there, and then negative 20 is probably a little something like here where my mouse is jiggling. So you can tell there's not a whole heap of a lot of difference in there. And it's the same for anything else. So if you're at blue, you know, plus 20 is not terribly different. Minus 20 is not terribly different. This is more of a tweak. This isn't like go crazy and do the selective color thing that was popular in Photoshop 20 years ago type tool. Hopefully this visual explanation kind of helps convey that. But that's what they mean by degrees. So you can come in here and you can rotate. You can rotate and you can see it's impacting it a little bit. I'm not sure how much of it will come through in YouTube, but as I rotate it, that the color, this red color here, changes as we're kind of rotating through here. Again, by the time YouTube mutilates this and compresses the ever-living bejeebers out of it, who the heck knows what you'll see. But you can see where it's doing just minor adjustments. This is more of like, again, this is more of like a fine scalpel instead of a nuclear warhead. This isn't supposed to really make huge adjustments to your color. It's just meant to kind of tweak it to get a specific tonality that you like. So I'm going to inset that red just a hair, maybe, and just to bring it down. We're going to adjust the contrast. I do like a bit of contrast. How are we doing on the clipping? You're getting a little bit there. So our next stop is tone equalizer, which I did a whole video on this not long ago. You should go and watch. I'll try to remember to put a link somewhere. Try to remember. I'm not promising, but I'll try. So we're gonna bring down the highlights here a little bit. You can see where this face is getting a little hot. Might try to bring out some details in her hair there a little bit. And there we go. This isn't the greatest photo in the world. It's just a good example, one I had laying around. All right, so you can see the difference there. We've adjusted that a little bit. We've recovered some details in her face and in the red background and whatnot. All right, good enough for me. Next stop is the next new module, or the other new module. There's only two I really want to show you. And I'm still kind of learning my way around this one, but it is the color equalizer, which, much like tone equalizer, presents color information, hue, saturation, and brightness in a equalizer format to where you can adjust things using these nodes, just like tone equalizer, but instead of brightness, you're dealing with color information. Or instead of EV information, you're dealing with exposure value information, you're dealing with color information. You can adjust, just like with tone equalizer, there's a guided filter in play here to separate out the color information into different areas for the filter to work on, or the module to work on, and you can kind of come and adjust that here. You can adjust the contrast, more contrast than the guided filter will make it sharper, make it harder contrast, less contrast will make it more gradual transitions. Saturation, threshold, this basically dictates where the filter is going to do its heavy lifting. If you adjust it up, it's going to only stick to areas with high chromaticity. And what chromaticity is, if I was thinking ahead, I would have thrown a Munsell color system chart here, but basically the Munsell is just like a stack of color wheels and on a center axis, right? And you get value going up the center axis. So down at the bottom is zero, which is like dark black. Up the top is lighter. Coming out from the center, you're increasing chromaticity. And what this means is that a lot of people confuse chromaticity And saturation. Saturation is actually chromaticity plus value. It is an intensity of a color plus a brightness factor, essentially. Brightness measurement is what it is. Whereas chromaticity is just plain intensity of the color. It's just how different it is from gray, right? So if you adjust this up, it's only going to affect really kind of intensely colored areas, and you can cut on your filter preview here to have a look. And we aren't doing a lot here because I've not done anything, but that's what that does. Next we have hue analysis radius. This, in order to separate out the different hues, it's got to figure out what values are exist in your image, and or I mean not what values what hue value what you know, there's basically hues represented as digital values, numbers in these images. And so when I say value, I'm not talking about color value. I'm talking about like a, hexadecimal number, basically. And so it's got to figure out what hues are in your images, how they're represented. If you have an image with a lot of chroma noise or strong large local variance, what that means is if you like zoom into the image and there's dramatic differences between pixels that are right next to each other, you can increase that hue analysis radius so that it takes a bigger swatch when it starts trying to figure out the hues and separate them out. Otherwise, if you've got a lot of local variance, it'll throw the filter off and have it act funny. Hue curve, change for a sharper or softer. You know, if you want the effect to be stronger, if you want it to be weaker, go either direction. White level, I have not found a good use for that one yet. And the same thing for the effect radius. Just to be upfront here, the Darktable 4.8 manual has not been completed yet. So I don't really have the in-depth details as what these modules do. I do build the nightly version of this on my Mac and on my Linux machine. So I kind of have a idea of what these are before it's released, but I think basically this white level will restrict the module to stay below a certain defined brightness level. So I'm thinking, this is a guess, a postulate, like if you have an image with a strong specular highlight and you don't want to impact the color in that highlight too much, you can adjust this white level here. As the tooltip says, the default is fine for most images, and I have found that to be the case so far. Up here in this top section of the module is where you'll be doing most of your work. We have got node placement, so you can move these around, once again, about 23 degrees, and you can adjust exactly where those nodes are placed. That's helpful because you can use your eyedropper tool here and say if you wanted to adjust something about this red here, you could drag it out there and you see that node doesn't quite line up with where that color is, where that hue is. So you can shift that out here and kind of get that node better placed. And so now if you wanted to desaturate that red color a bit, you could come here and do that. Unfortunately, like I said, it impacts the whole image. We can get into that a little bit later, as in with all things Darktable, you can mask. So you can come in later and mask that out from affecting that area. You can also, I'm gonna go in here in the eye and take a look at what color we've got there. You know, you got a yellow, greenish, you see some greens in there. So I'm gonna grab and make her eye a little bit more saturated, make it have a little bit more pop to it. Just to have something else to look at besides that red background. All right, and so we've done that. We can also come into the brightness, and that gives you a whole other thing of stuff to adjust, another set of nodes. So you can come in here and kind of grab, once again, in the same area. I just put my eyedropper tool there to make it easier. You can bring the brightness of these things down or up. We might bring the yellow down a little bit, the green up. And we've kind of made her eye pop out a little bit, I think. If we cut that on and off, you can kind of see it. See that eye kind of blinking in and out a little. I might bring that green up a little bit more. Okay, so we can come down here in the masking, and we can use this eyedropper tool here and select that color, and you can see it does its best, and then we can kind of play around. We need to display the mask, and there we go. Separate these out a little bit. There we go. Let's see what we get if we bring that up. Too much. We're basically doing is excluding parts of the image. And try to get that to exclude. Let's see if we keep going. That's gonna too much. You really wanna get rid of it in the lips there a good bit. Okay. And then we're going to feather that out and blur it out so it's not so blatantly obvious. Again, cut the mask back on. So now, as you can see, if we go to history here, well, I guess we can't really show the masking on or off. Oh yeah, I just cut the mask off there, right? So we cut the mask off, we can see the whole image affected. We can cut the mask back on, and you can see how we have really limited the damage to just the backdrop there. So with just a little bit of tweaking and some masking, we've changed that from a red backdrop to a magenta backdrop without a lot of fuss. Probably more on the masking than anything else. Had a little bit of a hiccup there. So that's kind of it for Darktable 4.8 kind of preview, a quick look at these two new modules. Hopefully this is helpful to someone. If you liked the video, I guess let me know. If you didn't like the video, also let me know. I'll get rowdy in the comments with you. It's okay. It doesn't matter. Anyway, I'm hopefully going to be throwing some new stuff at the channel too in a little bit, but I just wanted to get this out there before it got too much later and not as topical. So I appreciate you watching, and I will see you in the next one.